Good news, good news.
No matter what else is happening in the world.
Always good news, good news.
There is always good news today.
Welcome to Good News Today, the program where you will always find good news, no matter what else is happening in the world. I'm Jim Dearman, your host today for this edition of Good News Today. Thanks so much for joining us. And as always, I'm going to tell you what's coming your way on this edition of our program. Our devotional time begins every program. And if you're a regular part of our audience, you know that that devotional time consists of our scripture reading, beautiful singing, and then a brief study of our scripture. And today we go to the Constitution of Christianity, as it is often called, the Great Sermon on the Mount, preached by the greatest preacher who ever walked the earth, Jesus Christ Himself. We're going to look at the first six verses of Matthew chapter 7 as a part of that sermon. Matthew 7, 1 through 6. So get your Bibles, if you don't already have them, and open them to Matthew 7, and be ready to read along and study along with us in just a moment. Let's read together now Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 6. Jesus here says, "Judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, 'Let me remove the speck from your eye,' and look, a plank is in your own eye? Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Do not give what is holy to the dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you in pieces."
Since the love of God has shed priceless blessings on my head, I have made it my own. I am delighted in my heart that it never may depart.
And we are back for the study portion of our devotional time. And we hope you have your Bible still open to our reading from today, Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 6. As we mentioned earlier, of course, this is a part of the Great Sermon on the Mount, which has often been called the Constitution of Christianity, preached by the greatest preacher who ever walked the earth, Jesus Christ. And in this particular section of this sermon, these first six verses have really occasioned tremendous misapplication and misapprehension, but not because of the unclearness of what Jesus said. He made it very clear, and we can see the clarity with which He spoke about judging. Why do I say then that it's been misappropriated, misapplied? Because many will take this first statement, judge not that you be not judged. Right there we stop and say, don't judge me in any way, shape, form, or fashion. In other words, they claim that Jesus was prohibiting judging of any and every kind, and nothing could be farther from the truth. So, what is the case here? Judge not that you be not judged. Well, there's a particular type of judgment that Jesus was condemning here, and that's evident from the total context of Scripture. In fact, when we go to John chapter 7 and verse 24, Jesus said, do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. Now there, it's abundantly clear that Jesus was advocating a particular kind of judgment, judging what? With righteous judgment. How does one make a judgment according to righteous judgment? He does it by judging according to the Word of God. In other words, by examining the Word of God and then acting in accordance with that. We're called upon to make certain judgments, no question about it. In fact, before we're finished with our brief discussion of this text, we'll see that in this very context, we are called upon to make a judgment. You'll see what I mean in just a moment. So when Jesus says, judge not that you be not judged, he's talking about the kind of judgment that we are not able to make. In other words, judging a person's thoughts, judging a person's heart, the biblical heart, the mind, attributing actions to him that we have no way to attribute based upon not seeing what those actions are. You remember Jesus on another occasion said, by your fruits you shall know them. In other words, by the actions we can make a determination, but we don't judge a person's thoughts, etc. We don't unjustly judge or harshly judge. So he goes on here to say that with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. Now, that's really true in two senses, really. One is that generally speaking, when we misjudge others, others will have a tendency to misjudge us in return. But obviously, if we judge others in ways that prohibit forgiving them when we should be forgiving them, and we judge them in the sense that we won't be forgiving when we should, then can we expect forgiveness, or should we expect to be judged in that same way ultimately in the final judgment? The Lord will not forgive us if we do not forgive others. And so that's an example there where the judgment that will be returned to you or measured back to you will be generally by men, and ultimately you will be judged for your false judgment by the God of heaven through Jesus Christ himself. Now notice in this next verse, and why do you look at the speck, as the New King James says, in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? In other words, the admonition here is examine yourself. Reminds me of 2 Corinthians 13:5. Examine yourselves whether you are in the faith, Paul admonished there in that text. And so we need to make sure that that our house is clean, so to speak, that we are blameless before we seek to help anyone else. But now notice something very important here. Jesus does not say, don't examine the speck in your brother's eye, period. He says, don't examine it while you're not considering that you have a greater problem yourself. Now, when he goes on, verse 4, or how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your eye and look a plank is in your own eye. In other words, you're a hypocrite. That's what he next says in verse 5. But now notice this very important statement in the latter part of verse 5. First, remove, he says, the speck from your own eye. Now notice it. And then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Does he say we should never try to remove a problem from our brother? No. He says just make sure that you are in a position to do so because you are living the way you should. Luke 17:3, for example, comes to mind. There Jesus said, if your brother sins against you, reprove him. In other words, reprove him. Confront him with it. Do it in a good, loving way. And if he repents, forgive him. So that requires judgment, doesn't it? Of course it does. But now when we look at the last verse in verse 6 here of this text, we see judgment required in the very context in which many misapply the kind of judgment that Jesus condemned. He says, do not give what is holy to the dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you in pieces. How can we know whether or not someone is worthy of the gospel? How can we know that someone's not going to trample it underfoot and abuse it and not be good soil for the truth? How do we know that we should shake the dust off our feet, et cetera, as the Lord told His disciples on one occasion? How do we know that? We have to make a judgment. In other words, the very words of Jesus in verse 6 require a judgment on our part. Therefore, it's abundantly clear that not all judgment was being condemned by Jesus in this great text, especially when we consider not only the context here, but the larger context in which Jesus said, "Judge not according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment."